And we're live. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to another one of the Wealth Mosaic's Wealth Tech Talks. I'm Stephen Wall, co-founder and head of marketplace and content at the Wealth Mosaic. And today I'm joined by three guests from our ecosystem. And we are going to talk about the topic of data and how wealth managers can get the most out of data in their practice to elevate advisors, to support clients and to improve their business. So I am joined today by three guests. We have from CreaLogic, Anton Zobchuk, head of product, data aggregation and analysis. We have Boris Rankov, co-founder and head of products at InCube, now a Finantics company. And we have Theo Parakevopoulos, who's founder and CEO of Invest. So welcome to you all. Apologies, Theo. You know, I knew I'd struggle with pronouncing your name. I'd even get muddled. So guys, before we get into the topic, can I just ask you to introduce yourselves, what you do, the firm you work for, and a little bit of a headline view of, you know, where you're coming at from the topic of in the context of data. So Anton, if I go to you first.
Sure. So good morning, everybody. Hope you're having a nice Wednesday so far. As Stephen mentioned, I'm Anton, and I work for a company called CreaLogic. We're a leading supplier of client engagement solutions in the wealth, private banking, retail, and corporate banking space. And my area of focus within CreaLogic is kind of data and insights and how firms can leverage that to provide a competitive advantage. And that's really going to be what I talk about today a little bit, is how I think wealth management firms, private banks, can use the data that's within their system that maybe they don't know about at the moment or they don't access at the moment to create a competitive advantage, especially in the context of kind of this changing generational shift of clients that we have.
Great. Thank you, Anton. And Boris, to you for an introduction.
Hi. Good morning, everyone. My name is Boris. I'm a co-founder of InCube Group. InCube was acquired beginning of April by Finantics. At InCube, I'm head of products. We have an offering for wealth management where we offer different products that help wealth managers, private banks, how they can utilize their data in order to provide personalization in their financial advice. And I will also talk today about how, which use cases do we see at private banks and wealth managers, and what wealth managers are doing today to get the most out of the data.
Great, thank you, Boris. And Theo, to you.
Sure. So good morning, everyone. My name is Theo Parastivopoulos, and I'm the CEO of Invest. And we are a service platform combination that works with wealth managers, investment brands of all kinds, to build personalized digital experience. So that means websites, portals, apps, thought leadership, pieces, messaging. We're very much focused on a two-way information flow. So not just about publishing, but also collecting data and analytics. And this is mostly where our angle in terms of that, data management comes from. We're very much focused as a company on rapid value release. So we try to kind of get a project from start to time to value within 6 months. And data is an integral part of that. Now, we use a lot, we use car analogies a lot to describe what it is that we do. And in a digital transformation journey, if your app, your portal is the car, the vehicle, then data is the fuel. And we think that is so important that we come up with a term called data under management to challenge the supremacy of assets under management as a way for firms to measure the growth and the trajectory. And this is the kind of thing that we'll be talking today about.
Great, thank you, Theo. So just quickly for the audience, for those listening in, we'll be speaking to something like 45 minutes. There is a question option on the webinar. So if you have questions, we can answer those at the end. We're going to have quite a broad discussion talking generally about what data is and what it means for wealth managers, and then looking at the drivers, challenges, opportunities, use cases, as Boris mentioned, and really trying to understand how wealth managers can get the most out of data. So guys, you've given me a brief introduction to yourselves, your business, and some of your main thoughts. Can we talk about the drivers? So data is a topic that is now coming up, but it's very broad. It's, as Theo just mentioned, it's really the fuel of many of the things that the industry wants to try and do, particularly in the digital era. Anton, what I think you touched on it with your introduction, but what would you say are the drivers of the importance of data for wealth managers in today's world?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So I think one of the main drivers, and anybody who's heard me talk at kind of any of these sessions is I think one area that we talk about a lot at CreaLogix is this generational wealth shift. So over the next 5 to 10 years, it's expected to be upwards of $10 trillion transfers from the current wealthy generation into their children and those that they work with and those that they work closely with. And these are people whose experiences are driven by their interactions with things like Amazon, with Netflix, with Facebook, you know, highly personalized, highly data aware and data centric applications. And so these are consumers who are coming. They're not people who are getting used to the internet. They're people who are born with the internet. They're people who are used to being able to access all of their information anywhere in the world on any device. Like they're convenience users. And so one of the big drivers that we see in the market is definitely how do you not just how do you attract that new generation of customers, or how do you keep that generation of customers in a wealth shift from the current generation to the next generation, but how do you provide products and services that work for them? So for firms, that's about not just adjusting their digital experience, which is what we're mostly going to talk about today, but also adjusting their business model and adjusting the services that they offer to be competitive. That's one major driver. And then I think the other driver is, as is no more apparent in today's time than any other time, is kind of cost saving and competitive advantage. Especially in the wealth space, we're seeing this increase of challenges, or you're seeing firms who were previously maybe considered a bank becoming a bit of a challenger in the wealth space. They're moving into adjacent verticals in order to kind of drive revenues within the business. And I think it's about making sure that you as a firm are protecting yourself. And there's so much value in this data that you store, and the data that you're not collecting at the moment, or maybe some of the data you are collecting, but you don't know you're collecting it, or you don't know how to combine it with the other data. There's so much value in understanding what your users are doing within the system, understanding who they are, as opposed to just, you know, a customer number on a ledger somewhere. These are people who have demands, they have desires, they have goals, they have targets, they have things that, you know, they're going to have to plan for, things that they're going to have to fix over time. And so I think it's really important to understand that data can be a competitive advantage also in this space.
I think that's a nice view that they're not an entry anymore, just on a ledger system, right? That they are people.
Definitely.
Which moves the industry forward. Thank you for that, Anton. Boris, what's your view on the drivers of the importance of data?
Yeah, I think as Anton mentioned, cost savings. I mean, every bank is looking at cost income ratios. So on one hand side, you have the costs, and on the other side, you have to generate income. And cost has been in recent years going just in one direction, that is up for different reasons. You had wealth management, private banking, and banking is a highly regulated environment. And with MiFID II and other regulations that came in from European countries, banks had to make sure that they could support financial advisors and relationship managers at the point of sale, so that they can be compliant at all times. And that requires processing of lots of data and using systems. But in order to support that process, this being compliant at the point of sale, and in order to use systems, you have to have the data in the right format, and you have to have the data available. So in previous times, lots of data was sitting like in inboxes, email inboxes of relationship managers, or on SharePoint drives in free text format, and it was hard to use that by systems so that you can support relationship managers being compliant at the point of sale. So in order to do that, if banks first had to make sure that they have a proper data governance in place, they have proper data infrastructure. Data is collected properly, all the data is available, so that these data can be used by systems in order to make sure that the bank is at each time compliant. So that's like the first step. And this also helps you with achieving your cost savings, so that you can be really efficient during doing business. And on the second second side of this equation, so cost income, how can you utilize this data now to generate additional revenue, to be more efficient, that you can serve more clients with the same amount of relationship managers? And also here you can use technology in combination with data. For example, what we see as a hot topic, and banks are investigating into that, is how can you personalize your offering, your products that you are offering and services to your clients. How can you personalize that at scale? So that means, like, how can technology and data be used by relationship managers so that they can manage more clients, that this information can also be distributed through digital channels, client portals, e-banking, mobile apps in a personalized way to clients, so that you have higher client engagement and that clients are also investing into topics that are of interest to them. And this also, of course, then generates revenue for the bank.
Perfect, Boris. Thank you. Actually, Theo, that might lead nicely on to your view in terms of the portals and the personalization element. Would you back that up? Would you add additional elements to it?
No, absolutely. So Anton mentioned earlier about the importance of changing customer demands with a changing customer profile, people getting younger. So that's an important driver. Boris talked about efficiencies. That's also an extremely important driver, doing more with less. I will add one more here that actually piggybacks on those two, which is the data gives you actionable knowledge. Or another way of looking at it is data-driven action. So that is a way of saying that when a wealth manager, private bank, sets out a project, is about to take action, making the decisions based on data will make the project definition a lot more effective. That will give you the chance to avoid any traps, to increase accountability when you're reporting upwards. It will give you a chance to make the service offering a lot more personalized to individual customer needs. And that obviously goes both in the customer experience and the efficiency edge. Now, I have some stats from McKinsey study that this actionable knowledge can get some amazing results. If they can some 30% increase of revenue just by kind of doing prospecting, sales and marketing improvements, more personalized, etc. You can drive your costs down up to 30% just because of automation, data management, things like that. Now, obviously, these statistics can be, you know, coming from consultants, quite optimistic. But even so, even at the level that is half of that, it is at such a level, you were talking about a massively change, even a reimagined business. And that is, for us, is the essence of digital transformation. You get to make improvements at the scale that are truly transformative. The opportunity here, the driver, if you like, that there's a completely new digitally or data-driven organization emerges. The corresponding threat is that the competition is also going on that journey. The tools are widely available, and somebody gets the first might gobble up your lunch.
Perfect. Guys, well, thank you. There's obviously, you know, a lot to be achieved through the application and usage of data through firms improving processes. I've been having some conversations actually in Switzerland now, where the process of sort of data analytics and machine learning and applying new elements to institutions is happening for some of the reasons that you've mentioned. There are broad benefits, but where is the industry in terms of its status now with using, applying, understanding the opportunity through data? So, Anton, what's your view on that? You know, people often talk about wealth management being the laggards of one thing or another.
Sure.
Regard to technology. Is that fair? Or, you know, are they, where are they on the journey?
Whether you use the term laggard or not, I think it's relatively early on in the journey here. Especially when we talk about the sort of data that we're inferring here. So kind of like unstructured data and usage data, patterned behavior, as opposed to kind of the statistical quant data that firms are used to dealing with, right? Because we're talking about the financial industry. So it's already an industry that's very familiar with the term data and the concept of analyzing data and understanding the impact of that. You know, that's why these firms are still in business. Their ability to read the financial market data and understand what's going to happen, or best defend about what's going to happen. So I think the wealth management industry kind of is at the start of its journey, same really across the board, especially if you compare it to somewhere like e-commerce, right? If you look at e-commerce or tech as a wider area, they're so far ahead of so many other industries when it comes to this kind of data. You look at just how quickly and easily these sorts of things are in our daily lives. I mentioned Netflix earlier. You know, how often do you open Netflix on your TV, your phone, your iPad, whatever it is, and you find a recommendation that you actually want to watch? It's quite terrifying how accurately they know that I want to watch terrible shows about people restoring cars. They've got that nailed, you know, like they really know what I want to watch. And so we're being programmed to expect these behaviors. And the people that work within these firms are realizing the value of those behaviors as they're used in other areas. So I think they're definitely at the start of the journey, especially compared to places like e-com or some of the other industries. But I don't think that that's necessarily that unexpected, given that it's a relatively new topic for the industry. And I don't think that they're not in a bad position to capitalize on that. I just think it's like, it's the start of the journey. And so firms have to understand that it's going to take time, partnerships, experience, knowledge. Theo mentioned earlier that the kind of data is the fuel to your car. And there's this term that everybody always talks about, you know, data being the new oil. But Brent crude on its own is absolutely useless to run your car, right? You need to be able to take Brent crude and turn it into petrol for it to be of any use fueling a vehicle or diesel or whatever your fuel is. And so the key part of that is understanding and building the ability, either through partnerships with firms like all of us talking today or through internal business units, is about building the understanding of that data.
Perfect. That's an interesting point. So obviously data in the industry is long-term, you know, in terms of market data and financial products. But in this area, in the digital age, in terms of understanding clients' behavior, personalization, it's new. Boris, what's your thinking on that question?
Yeah, as Anton said, I also definitely think we are at the start of the journey. So, I mean, of course, financial companies, wealth managers, they are used to work with data, you know. So, let's say, typically, they have very complex spreadsheets. They connect the spreadsheets with Bloomberg or Reuters or other financial information systems. They do lots of analysis about markets, products. They are, let's say, quite familiar working on in this area with data, you know, when it's about investment processes, analyzing markets, and analyzing classical data sets, structured data that fit into Excel, let's say. Next step they do is they have like groups in the business that start to work, you know, using Python or R or other scripting languages that they can do more advanced analytics than in a spreadsheet that can connect to, let's say, some data warehouses and extract data, or connect to Bloomberg and do some analysis. Mainly, let's say, in the area of economic research, markets research, in order to improve the investment processes. In terms of, let's say, utilizing client data, I think they are far less advanced. Focus, as I said, was on automating compliance at the point of sale, so getting the data to do that correctly, but you don't need analytics and AI and machine learning for that. That's mainly rule-based, but still, also rules, they require the data to be accessible. Today, my observation is they focus on digitalizing the last mile, so offering digital channels to clients so that relationship managers can work remotely with their clients. Clients have access through client portals, mobile apps, e-banking to all the services of the bank. So this is like focused now. And of course, through these digital channels, you collect lots of data about clients as well. So I think this is like the next step where wealth managers will, you know, do more research like they do like for investments and markets, analyzing client behavior. But in order to do that, you need to have, you need to have a governance in the company, you need to have infrastructure. How do you develop models? How do you put them into production? As an example, I made like the wealth manager are used to work with spreadsheets. But within spreadsheets, you can only load a certain amount of data. You cannot load in an Excel, thousands of gigabytes of data, because it doesn't fit into the memory of your computer. And also the number of Excel rows is limited. You cannot load unstructured data. You know, as soon as you have free text data, you maybe want to analyze web navigation logs. It becomes quite difficult doing that in Excel. So what you need is like probably an infrastructure that allows you to process unstructured data, to process big data. So if the data does not fit into the memory of the developer using Python, you need technologies like big data storage, big data processing, where you just work on chunks of the data and then combine the results. And what we see today is, banks, I think they're quite far with organizing the data and making it accessible. But what is now missing is having the operating models to deploy analytics, to put AI models into production and integrate them into business processes so that they can really get actionable value out of this. And I think this is like the next step we will see in the evolution of this topic at wealth management companies.
Great, thank you, Boris. So Theo, would you largely agree with that the processes to store and maintain and collect this information is there, but they're not yet well equipped to do the analysis and create actionable developments from that?
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is that not only I agree with that, but I mean, we all started by saying that in the financial services industry, people are accustomed to using good data. But I actually think that right now in the transition over to behavioral analytics, et cetera, this is actually a hindrance at the moment. It's not something that helps. And we make a distinction between two types of data strategies here. There's offensive data, defensive data. Financial services are very good at defensive data. It's your golden master, is the operational data, is the data that needs to be protected at all costs, accuracy, integrity, timeliness, everything that you need for reporting, compliance, et cetera. Now, offensive data, which is the data that we're talking about here, is the stuff that needs to be mostly flexible, complete, flowing. Accuracy is important, but not as important as having continuous flow. It's the stuff that you need to make a copy, manipulate, throw away if you need to train an algorithm or analyze whatever it is that you do. But it's a different beast from the defensive data. And I think that financial services need to make that switch, need to make that mindset switch that will allow them to create that separate data strategy to create insights from. We see that we tend to break wealth managers into three types of companies based on where they are in their transformation journey. So I don't think that there is one answer for absolutely everyone. You've got some early stage companies and they are still maybe launching the first generation of a portal of an app. It's mostly one-way data, just distributing information. They probably have got one or two data sources, so their data under management is very low. You've got evolving companies, probably on a second, third generation portal. They have got an array of formats, digital formats that they communicate with clients. They see some value of analytics, but they're not quite making that jump yet. Maybe they're collecting the analytics and then just looking at it every month. There is some players out there. There are some companies out there that are quite advanced, early adopters, if you like. Their challenge there is agility. So they already are collecting the data, multiple sources, combining them, etc. But as the projects come and go, they kind of need to have the agile mindset to let that flow throughout the organization to operationalize the data, if you like. So not everybody's there, but everybody needs to make at some point or another, they need to make that split between offensive and defensive data.
And that's an interesting point. I think it's the cultural element to this, so the accepted practice, the way they've done business for years, is perhaps a barrier to change. Anton, do you see other areas of challenge for wealth managers in moving from the old means of market data to the new means of sort of client behavioral data that is accepted in digitalization?
Yeah, sure. And I think actually the cultural is kind of primarily my view and opinion on this, and I think Theo started to touch on it a little bit earlier, and I'm sure Theo and Boris will have some really good insights as to kind of the technical challenges, because those definitely do exist as well. But I think there is quite a bit of a cultural change that needs to happen within these firms. Theo used the term data under management as kind of a metric. And one of the metrics that we talk to a lot of our customers about, and this is how we use to understand kind of where they are on their digital lifecycle, is age of your customer. You know, how many wealth management firms do you know track at a board level the average age of their customer as a KPI? That's something that people didn't do 2 or 3 years ago, that more and more firms are starting to do now. You know, the more firms I ask this question of, more and more of them are now starting to say, yeah, actually we track that. And I think terms, you know, whether it's the term data under management or whether it's something else, I think we'll start to see things like client engagement and digital usage and, you know, digital cost per user become metrics that are tracked really in the upper echelons of the business. And I think in order to track that and drive that and push that, there needs to be a cultural change within the business, not just kind of generally cultural change within the business, but also in the makeup of the people in the senior management teams. You know, like, how many wealth managers do you know have a CDO? How many wealth managers do you know that have somebody with the term data, or somebody with the term insights, or somebody with that term really in the senior management of the business? We're seeing people with the words like transformation officer or digital officer, but we haven't really reached that paradigm shift yet where data and insights and engagement metric people are really in the senior level of the business. And I think that's one challenge that the businesses face is not just kind of the wider corporate culture of understanding how to interact with this different type of qualitative and unstructured data, but also within the senior management and the strategy of the business. They should be using, as both Boris and Theo have mentioned already, they should be using this data to help validate their decisions. Whenever you see anybody in the tech industry, everybody's always talking about data-driven decisions. And I think it's a term that hasn't really infected the financial services industry quite yet in the same way that it has the tech industry. So I think starting to understand that this data cannot just be used to help drive revenues and drive cost savings, it can actually be helped materially in your decision-making process, so that when you're talking to the board, when you're talking to the senior management, when you're talking to anybody, when you're talking to your customers, you know, like, why should they care about the data within the system? You can provide them with demonstrable use cases and demonstrable examples and real value add to them as to why you're doing this work. I think that cultural piece is one of the most significant challenges.
Thank you, Anton. So, Boris, would you agree with that? I mean, do you think culturally wealth managers really understand the value of data and how to extract that, or do they just use the terms because they're fashionable and then go back to traditional practice?
No, absolutely. I totally agree with Anton. And that's what I mentioned earlier. You have to have in place a target operating model for analytics. And target operating model does not only mean like you have to have the infrastructure, technology, and all the tools in place. You also have to have governance and organization. So as Anton said, there also must be responsibility and ownership on this in the senior you know, management, and even on board level, like the chief data officer, etc. And always in an analytics journey, you always start with you know, like, what we call descriptive analytics. So first you have to understand the data you have. You have to understand the metrics, all the KPIs, how you calculate them, and in order to understand your business. And based on that, you can also understand what are your use cases where you can drive cost savings and revenues, and what is, like, you know, what are the tools and what are the technologies and what is the talent you need in order to implement that? So, you know, not every use case. So many wealth managers, you know, have use cases where you don't need, for example, let's say big data processing or big data tools. So it's not, you really have to understand what is your business about, how you drive revenues, what are the use cases. And based on these use cases, you have to decide about putting the right technology and the right tools in place in order to drive these use cases like to the last mile. And then you have to think about how do you measure the success of that? And that goes back into your KPIs you define. And then you measure on an ongoing basis and you report them you know, to senior management. And that's what Anton said, that's part of this governance you have to establish as part of your target operating model.
So fundamentally, with the application of data, it's not really different to anything else that a business should do. You know, so if they're establishing a digitalization program, they have those governance structures, KPIs, target operating models in place. There's nothing different about doing it in the data world.
Exactly.
Okay. Theo, would you anything to add there in terms of this discussion?
Absolutely. I will go back to what it is that you just said just now, and just highlight something. Data has got something that is very different in terms of digital and technology than any other work that you do. So when we build software, a portal, etc., we can create something tangible even from day one. You know, the initial sprint that you can get something out is something that people can see. Now, with data, there is a calculation that 80% of the work is actually legwork. It's stuff that needs to happen up front collecting the data, cleansing it, labeling it, grouping it, augmenting it, all that stuff. So before you get to see any value, you actually have to make quite a significant investment. Add to that things like privacy concerns, whether the data is accurate, the cost of doing all this, legacy systems that you have to add in there. All I'm trying to say is that specifically to data analytics, there are significant headwinds that you don't find in other or in the broader technological spectrum. Now, add to that one more thing. Sometimes, you know, we're having this conversation, we're all data enthusiasts over here, even data scientists, and we see the value of data. But for business people in the boardroom, this can be quite abstract. The benefits could be quite far away, a little bit too vague. There might not be enough pull for management to actually make it happen. So the way that we see it, given all these challenges, the key problem here is to actually get going, is to actually build something that relatively quickly will be able to illustrate at C-suite level that there is value in here, that you can actually collect the data, use that offensively as I described earlier, and then deliver a dashboard, a KPI, some actionable knowledge, a profile of your entire business. For that Anton mentioned, you know, what is the average age of your customer? Let's talk about financial personality. Let's talk about how they match with your product definition and whether you that should flow into decisions that you make over there. So what we say is start small and then build up. Like we do that with everything. The headwinds are strong, and especially when it comes to all the legwork that is associated with managing data. But you start small, you pick one small API, then you add to that, you add to that. Before you know it, you have a dashboard. Before you know it, you have got like an ongoing reporting engine and suite, and then you build that from there. There's no point in starting with a massive two-year project and then realizing halfway through that that's not the KPIs that are important to us. Start small and build up.
Perfect. And so that brings me to the better part of the discussion, in the sense we don't want to talk about challenges, we want to talk about opportunities. So if we just think small scale, first of all, Theo, just to continue, start small, build from there, don't go big and cause yourself too many problems. So have you got sort of live examples or ideas where you think actually wealth managers can make these small changes and see immediate results? Is there something that you can provide in terms of clarity there?
Yeah, sure. So one of the use cases I have been contributing is from a client in the private banking domain. And they started small with what a lot of even financial advisors at a smaller level might do. They started with a profiling campaign. So they asked, they had the campaign where they asked all their customers to put a little bit more color into the very basic risk profiling information that was collected during onboarding. So they started with that. And then what they did, they talked to some academics in the psychology area, and then they refined those questions. They ran the campaign again, and all of a sudden, this profiling system became a much more advanced financial personality system. Now, that already was very powerful in the sense that it gave them an idea of how clients regarded themselves, what was their own attitude to wealth, their own attitude to risk, security, family, all these things. But they didn't stop there. See, where it became really powerful was they started correlating this information that was explicitly given by customers with financial and behavioral data. So the next step was to actually combine that with somebody's portfolio size, somebody's asset allocation, and let's see, are there any gaps there? And then the third step that we did at the very end was to combine that once again with behavioral data. At that point, we started collecting and feeding back into how people were using the website or the portal, how often they were logging in. We have got these tangible, these measures of stress use, where you can jumping around screens, logging in a little bit too frequently, logging in, logging out, different screens every day, tapping in, moving around quite a lot. And that can be an element of, if you like, stress using of an app. So we built all these things together, and then we started seeing gaps. We started kind of seeing opportunities emerging. So you correlate this together with the products and the asset allocation, and maybe there is something that the portfolio manager would call them up, and then to see, is everything okay over there? Now, you're telling us that you are quite adventurous in your attitude, yet when things go south, you seem to be quite stressed about it. That then flowed into compliance, and it kind of, you know, there was a whole array of benefits that flowed in there. So that kind of onboarding process, if you like, that started in the very, very beginning, the things I don't know about my clients, actually cascaded all the way to this dynamic customer profiling that that became useful across the business. But it all started from something small.
Perfect. Thank you, Theo. Anton, what's your view? So that Theo gave a nice picture there, starting small and then correlating broader data sets to create a broad, you know, a 360-degree profile, if you will, of your client. What's your view on wealth managers and how they can move things forward in the data world? What do they need to do? Where can they maintain or deliver quick wins?
Sure. So I think Theo is absolutely right. As with all of these IT projects, right, we always hear about the giant failures where somebody has tried to bite off too much, you know, try and take a massive chunk out straight away. And so I think, as well as starting small, firms can think about starting simple. You asked us a question earlier about where do you think firms are on their journeys? And, you know, just with the firms that I interact with, either customers or prospects or friends in the industry, you have such a, like, quite a wide gamut of people who are, you know, as Boris said earlier, you've got the people kind of in the middle who capture a lot of data and they store a lot of data, but they don't really know what to do with it. And then you've got some of the customers that Theo talked about working with earlier who are really kind of investigating the next level of taking that sort of more advanced and thematic and usage data and doing interesting and clever tools with it. There are still huge swathes of the industry that are kind of at day one, where they're kind of just starting to capture usage statistics. You know, how many customers do we have logging in daily? What are they doing when they log in? How many times are they logging in a day? What type of devices are they logging? And even if you're just at that, because I think one of the challenges we didn't necessarily maybe talk about is how scary this topic can be. Because, you know, if you're a wealth manager and you're in IT and you're like, right, okay, so the board have told me that we need to do some more AI and ML stuff in wealth management. So you start Googling advanced analytics in wealth management. You're just going to get the world's most complicated Medium articles about writing data science in Python and you know, Spark and Hadoop clusters and ETL processes. And you're just going to be like, okay, this is just too complex. So I think also it's important to remember that you can start relatively simple with basic things like usage tracking and basic usage analytics. You know, where are your customers logging in from? Is that the same place that their country of residence is from, or perhaps, you know, maybe have they moved country? Are they one of your customers that spends a lot of time internationally? So maybe if you're a bank, do you want to be kind of less hot on the fraud of their cards abroad? You know, are they moving around a lot? Do you expect their transactions to happen abroad? Is it a customer who's always in the same location? And so when you see transactions occurring from a different country, that should be an immediate red flag to you. I talked earlier about using data to drive your decisions. When you're thinking about where to invest your money, what better way to determine what functions of your client portal you should invest money in than knowing which functions they use most often? And then once you've got that basic understanding, then you can start to do some of the more interesting things, like, okay, so on average, our customers log in, they go to the dashboard, they scroll 3/4 of the way down the page, and they click on this widget more often than the others. So what do you do? Well, in future iterations, you move the location of that widget up the page. And that's kind of step one. And then step two is, instead of having to do a release to move that widget to the top of the page, your dashboard is automatically organizing itself based on the usage that your customers have shown. So historical data patterns. You know, customer A logs in, they always spend two to five minutes on the dashboard, and they always interact with these three or four pieces of data. So let's put that at the top of the screen. And then kind of step three, or the sort of more advanced stages, is starting to do a bit more of the sort of black box AI ML prediction of that. So instead of basing it just on historical patterns, you say, okay, towards the end of the month, we know that our customers are more interested in the amount of money they have left in their accounts or the investment decisions that have happened this month than they are on things happening next month. So by default, instead of waiting for them to use those widgets and bring them up the page in terms of order, your system is predicting and saying, okay, so it's towards the end of the month, therefore I know my customers are more interested in this information, so I'm going to show this information more readily to them. And those are the kind of steps. Like, I do think it's really important not to get kind of lost in the panacea, you know, this is where we're going to be in a couple of years' time, like Theo said, to kind of start small, start simple, build up. It's a scalable process. It's something that you're going to build the knowledge, you're going to build the infrastructure, you're going to build the governance, you're going to start to be able to explain to your board and your senior management what value you're generating from these. So don't try and go like too complex too quickly. Really start with the basics, get them sorted, start to understand and use that data daily. Like Theo said, you know, don't just go and check your usage stats monthly, check your usage stats daily, check them weekly, use them as part of your marketing decision process, use them as part of your product decision process, use them as key metrics when you're making business decisions, and then move on to the more complicated, the really interesting, the kind of sexy data predictive stuff that we talk about as well, because that's the fun, that's the interesting stuff we get to. You have to have that groundwork first.
Great. Thank you, Anton. Boris, do you have I presume maybe a similar view in terms of simple steps, do things on a short-term basis rather than long-term plans that could fail easily? And if so, you know, what are the kind of things that you've seen with clients in the market from a real-life use case?
Yeah, I mean, that's clear. You always like, that's like also in the agile process, you start small with a minimum viable product and then you build it up iteratively based also on feedback, that's clear. But I think what we have observed, let's say with our clients, many clients ask, let's do first a proof of concept or proof of value within a short time frame. And what we often then see is like, you know, they perform the proof of concept, but it never gets like, to the last mile where it is really then implemented in production and integrated into production's, let's say, workflows. Because often in analytics projects, of course, there are different KPIs. You can measure the success of a proof of concept. But often with analytics projects, like the proof of the pudding is really in the eating. So you have to put that system live. You have to in advance define like what are the KPIs you want to measure, how can you also assess the return on investment, how much did you invest in setting this up, and what is the real value that it brings, so how much more revenue are you doing. And for example, one way you can do that, for example, we are very active in recommendation engines or next best action, and the whole idea is you want to personalize all the products and offerings and services a bank or wealth manager has, so to basically provide the right advice to the right client at the right time. And what's the hope is, of course, the client feels better advised, it's personalized, there is a higher client engagement, but at the end, it generates also measurable more revenue for the wealth manager. And in order to properly test that, you typically do A-B testing. So A-B testing means you have two groups. One group gets like the personalized advice through the data-driven machine learning-based engine, and the other group gets the classic, let's say, driven by marketing top-down recommendations. And then you measure like where do you have higher client engagement, higher client satisfaction, and finally where you have more revenue. And you can't prove that in a proof of concept. So I agree, you should start small. With minimum viable products, but you still have to think end to end, So what is really the return on investment? What are the KPIs? How do we put that into production? And how do we measure success? And this is more than mid-term thinking and long-term thinking. So you have to, in analytics, it's a bit different than, let's say, to minimum viable products where you do a new screen for a new dashboard, and in the client portal, you can start very small and you can easily test whether it's successful or not. But with analytics, it's a bit more difficult. You have already in the beginning, think about the end-to-end process, which makes it more difficult because it requires higher investment, and you are not sure about the outcome. Will it really bring more value or not? And no data scientist can tell you that, so you can only measure it when it's live and you have the interactions and you measure your KPIs, then you can, after a while, you can assess whether, this approach has brought some value or not.
So, Boris, quickly to follow up on that, does that then create challenges for you in terms of getting firms to move if they're not sure what value they're going to get in a period of time through a proof of concept? They've got to invest for a longer period. And what do you do in terms of persuading them that those are the challenge or that is the route to take?
I mean, it's definitely a barrier for companies because they have to think about do they really want to make these investments. So when you do proof of concept, you should from the beginning start to think about how do you measure the success of that specific use case, and how can you make it happen also end to end with a small investment? And that I think this is really the key to the success of these projects. But it's definitely, let's say, you know, in terms of where are wealth managers investing, everything what is coming from a regulatory or compliance point of view, they have to invest in. But when it's about how can you utilize what is in your data, how can you maybe generate more revenue, it's not a must, right? So maybe the budgets are today more in terms of investing into the last mile, the digital channels, you know, and this is okay as well, because you first have to have that in place, because that's also the place where you collect all the data about your clients and how they interact with the wealth manager. And then, you know, how do you utilize that data? This is like the next step in your journey, and this has to be planned carefully. As I said, you know, if you want really to be serious about that, you have to have an operating model for that. You have to identify what are the use cases, what are the technologies and tools you need mid-term to long-term in order to become really a data-driven organization. Yep. And in order to prove that, you first start with proof of concept, with proof of value projects. But different from, let's say, classical software engineering projects, you already have there to think end-to-end and also to put proof of concepts into production, test it on real clients, doing A/B testing and measuring the return on investment. Only then you can basically decide about the next steps.
Great. I think we have another 10 minutes or so. I want to come on to tools and technologies, but quickly, Theo, just thinking what Boris just said earlier, you talked about, I think, offensive versus defensive. So your regulatory projects in regard to data are perhaps defensive projects, but more behavioral client understanding is maybe more offensive. How can make firms shift from one to the other? So one is a must have and the other is a nice to have. How do you move them to nice to have?
I think you'd start by framing it as not nice to have, but as a must have of the future. All it takes is for one of the big tech companies to move into investment management in any form, and that's it. The industry is upended. So far, they haven't done it, but if they do, the reach that they have in terms of data, technology, customer brand awareness, customer experience, is not something that probably even the biggest financial corporates can match. So it hasn't happened yet. It doesn't mean that it won't happen. It doesn't mean that one of the existing big companies is not going to move into that domain. And when they do move into that domain and they do have the data and the analytics, then they're going to wipe the floor with everyone else. So that offensive data is nice to have now, but it won't be for long. So once you do see it this way, you actually say your defensive data needs to stay where it is, your golden master, compliance, accuracy, etc. That needs to stay where it is in your data centers. But that project that will move you to the offensive data, that is not a nice to have anymore.
Okay. So you have to
maybe just to add one comment. What I use often is, you know, there is like trilobites is a prehistoric form of crabs. So 500 million years ago, they developed some kind of eyes or light detector. And that gave them a huge competitive advantage in the evolution. So the trilobites prey, but also predators, they had to evolve, you know, in order to survive. And you can use that. I think every company, not only, or every firm, not only wealth management, but in other industries, if you don't utilize the data that you have in your company, you know, to manage better the company internally, so, you know, to get the best talent, to retain your talent, but also external data and data about your clients to serve them better, you will just fall behind competition. And of course, today, maybe the focus is more on digitalizing the last mile. But also, you know, wealth managers, they have to use more data in investment processes as well. So using alternative data sets, you know, not just the classical data that is publicly available to everyone in order to provide superior performance, because it's not only important to be very personalized in your servicing and in your product. At the end, with wealth managers, their core expertise is in providing superior performance in a personalized way. So also there, they have to start to utilize data, different data sets that are available, unstructured data, or otherwise they fall behind competition. And so, yeah, that's my view.
I find amusing the analogy of the dinosaur analogy, I suppose.
Yeah, we're not calling anyone
dinosaur creatures. dangerous, but also amusing. Quickly, you know, so we talk about, well, I'm more familiar, let's say, with core banking systems, portfolio management systems, Excel, e-portals and whatever else. In this kind of data world, what are the bit that I'm confused about? Anton, you've talked about sort of programming languages and all sorts of different things. What is the technological toolkit that makes data available and powerful for wealth managers? Is it their existing infrastructure, or do they need a whole load of different technologies, tools and skills?
So I like to think about kind of the people side of this, and as I'm sure Theo and Bosch will kind of talk to some specific technologies there, and there are lots of them. I think it's about having the people to operate those technologies, because you can have the world's most complex technology stack, right? But if you don't know how to move your data through that stack, so starting up with data ops, so that's a term that, it, think of data ops to data what DevOps was to kind of like continuous integration and continuous deployment, right? It's about making sure you're capturing data automatically, processing data automatically, and getting it into your sort of understanding layer automatically. So whenever I talk about these subjects with people, I always break it out into three areas: capture, understand, and act or engage. So once you automate your capture part of it, and there's loads of tools, there's literally hundreds of thousands of tools you can get for that. And it's about finding people who can operate those tools, people who are partners or people, you know, we're all here as companies who provide firms with these services, so they don't have to build up all of this structure in-house. That's another, you know, really important point there, is you don't have to do this all yourselves. Your key competence, as Boris mentioned earlier, is in outperforming the market and providing financial services to your customers. You don't have to be tech companies. Some firms like Starling have taken a very distinct opportunity. You know, they want to be a tech company with a banking license. That's always how they used to describe themselves. I don't think they maybe do that as much as they used to, but they definitely used to have the tagline of their website, we're a tech company with a banking license. But not every wealth management firm wants to be that. And I don't think every wealth management firm wants to or needs to be that. So get your data operations in place, get the data loaded into the right place where you can start to do work on it. And then there's a plethora of tools. You know, there's a never-ending debate of R or Python for data science. You know, you've got tools like open source capabilities around TensorFlow for doing more next level kind of deep neural, multiple layer neural networks. You've got Boris mentioned earlier things like Google BigQuery and Big Data to provide more computing power for this. You know, we know when we start to drill into especially kind of multiple layer neural networks, the computing power you need is really, really complex. But again, without that, without the people to operate it, the partners to operate it, doesn't matter how good your technology is. And then in terms of acting and engaging, there's a whole array of different functionalities and tools you can use to provide insights. You know, Boris mentioned things like next best offer and next best action technologies to provide better and more targeted marketing, better and more targeted product suggestions. I gave the use case example area of having, you know, dynamic dashboards. That's a concept I really firmly believe in. You know, as a user of a whole bunch of different dashboard apps on my phones and my desktops, you know, if I had one where when I log in, it just presents me with the data I know I'm going to go and search for anyway, that would be a much better user experience. You know, it's about asking questions and getting answers rather than searching for data is how I want to interact with my things. You know, we're programmed that way with things like with Alexa, and I won't mention Google Home because my Google Home will then start talking at me. All of these various different things, you know, we're programmed now to ask questions and get responses rather than search in Excel spreadsheets and do complicated things. And so it's about making sure that third pillar, that kind of engage or act, is presented to your clients in a way that they want to interact with it. So tools and technology is really, really important. And there's a lot of really good stacks out there, proven stacks that firms like Netflix, and eBay and Amazon, and a lot of these firms are a lot more open with their technology than they used to be, especially in the startup space, right? You know, it's on almost a badge of honor now to talk about some of the technology you use. You know, like we use React Native, we use AWS, we use Node.js. You know, that's kind of a badge of honor now, whereas technology used to be the thing that was hidden in the corner and nobody really wanted to talk about, or that's the tech people, they're interested in that, the rest of us aren't. Now it's starting to be a bit more of a public topic, but I think my just closing stance on that would be, focus on the tools and technologies because they're gonna determine how successful your groundwork is, but focus on the people and the partners to operate that technology and those tools. Otherwise, it's just like, what good is it? It's not going to get you anywhere.
Yeah, Boris, what's your view? I mean, are wealth managers capable of making these technological decisions? Do they have the infrastructure already? Do they need to do different things?
I think it depends on the size of the wealth manager. So of course, bigger wealth managers are already on the way, and they have they have big IT departments with lots of talent and architects, and they can evaluate what they will build in-house, where they will partner with external partners, utilizing a rich ecosystem. I would say smaller wealth managers are more dependent on partners to help them to build that up. And as Anton said, you have to think about where do you want to invest, let's say, in-house. I mean, in terms of, let's say, to provide superior investment performance, to utilize alternative data sets, different data sets, and where you basically, create alpha for your clients, you maybe don't want to share that with other wealth managers, let's say, and you want to keep that for you, and that's your core competence. But let's say in terms of utilizing recommendation engines to better personalize the services you offer to your clients, so the best-in-class products that you have in-house, you probably don't want to build the R&D for that in-house, because actually you can't really commercialize that, right? So you can't sell you don't want to sell these recommendation engines to other wealth managers, because you are not a tech shop, you are a private bank, or you are a wealth manager. So there, it makes more sense to partner with vendors or partners that focus on that topic, that do lots of R&D. These systems are also kind of pre-trained. They are trained on data of many different clients of wealth managers. So it's already clear where the parameters are, when you come to a new client, you just have to train the models on the new data. So there is lots of efficiency gains you can get. So I think you have to differentiate what are the use cases that are important for you as a wealth manager, and you want to keep the secret sauce, and what are the use cases where you can't compete if you don't use best-in-class products out in the market.
Yeah. Theo, what's your view finally on this last question?
I echo what both Anton and Boris said about people being important, but I won't spend too much time on that, partly because it has been answered exhaustively and partly because people pay us for the technology expertise. So I'll provide a bit of our approach from that. We see data and analytics as being a child of cloud computing, and that is a given for us. That is an absolute. It would be incredibly hard to do data analytics efficiently and effectively if you rely on in-house resources. The innovation is not there, the scale is not there, the costs are different, security, connectivity, all these things. If you have got in-house networks, you probably have got more people than you need to if you rely exclusively on that. Now, I think that the industry has made, especially in the UK, has made significant moves towards IT modernization and moving to the cloud. So I'm not going to spend too much time over there. I will say that we, as Invest, we're a Microsoft Azure house. We use that. But of course, I know that AWS and other providers have got similar tools. And there is innovation, R&D, that you can piggyback on. There is existing machine learning capabilities. There is models that you can take advantage of and start small and build up, as we said earlier, AI engines, get democratized. There is a scale that you cannot, that is unprecedented in terms of computing, but also storage power. You can get cheap, schema-less data stores to collect all your data. And then, of course, there is a whole array of connectivity apps, logic apps, web applications, whatever it is, that will help you operationalize your data. So you can build your APIs and hook them up onto your CRM so that your portfolio managers can use it before a meeting. You can use the data to personalize the portal as the user logs in, etc. A big important point about cloud computing is also that it enables or is a cornerstone of DevOps or data ops, design ops, all these terms that kind of come together. You marry them up into this technical infrastructure and you're able to star or everything ops your organization. Essentially, you get to operationalize the technology stack. And this is at the heart of it. have to make sure that the technology flows through everything. That is not just, well, I think Anton just started by saying that it's just the guys in the corner doing the technology. It flows through everything. And as machine learning, cloud is an important part of that.
Perfect. Gentlemen, we have hit the hour. There is a risk, I believe. I think this happened before. We get kicked off before I do the final point. I'm going to ask you one quick question with a very short answer, and it relates to the title. So, you know, one move any firm can make to maximize the benefit they get from data. Can you each give me sort of a 5-10 second answer to highlight what you say that would be? Anton first.
Get people in your organization who can take that data and understand it.
Perfect. And to you, Boris?
Start to think from the beginning end to end, and how do you measure success?
Perfect. And to Theo, finally?
For the 50th time, I will say start small and build up.
Perfect. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for that. We ran over the hour. There's a hell of a lot to talk about in that topic. I hope we got some we certainly got some interesting stuff, and I hope the audience would take away some great insights and some actionable insights from that. If anyone wants to ask questions, feel free to drop us an email. I'm sure the guys will be happy to respond to those. But again, gentlemen, thank you for your time. Much appreciated. And we hope you all have a very good rest of the day.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.
Thanks, everyone. Good day.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Bye.